Ready?
Well.
Welcome, everyone, to the January 22nd City Council public hearing. We have five hearings this evening. Councilor Zelenka is not going to be here, and Councilor Clark asked me to pass on that his son is ill. He's home with his son taking care of him. He'll be listening and submit his questions in writing. The rest of us are here and ready to go. And the first public hearing is on an ordinance concerning charges for stormwater and park services. City Manager?
Thank you, Mayor. This public hearing is to consider an amendment to the current stormwater fee structure to allow a transition of the costs of operating and maintaining city parks, open space, and natural areas from the general fund to the stormwater fund. Transition of funding for parks costs from the general fund to the stormwater is proposed as part of the FY14 plan of action in order to reduce general fund expense and thereby maintain services and avoid further cutbacks affecting quality of life for the community. The transition would also provide a more stable ongoing funding source for parks maintenance.
Thank you, City Manager. So I'm going to open the hearing, and we have 22 people signed up for this. So first up is Ruth Demler, followed by Bob Sigmund.
Ruth Demler, 1745 for Crest, Eugene. Yesterday, the president announced that he wanted a tax change, a change in how we do our taxes. And I think at the state level, many are talking about changing in how we have our tax system. This is really the wrong time of the year with all this cold weather for you to be putting on another fee on the utility bill. It isn't a fee, it's a tax. It's a regressive flat tax. For someone making $200,000, $240 a year, which it could be, isn't really an exorbitant price. But for a person who makes $10,000, $12,000, or even my teacher daughter, who's raising two kids as a single mother, a $240 addition to her utility bill for the year is really a little bit more than she can really face right at the moment. This is a regressive tax. And I see one regressive tax after another added on to our fees. When I look at my bill for 2007, or 1996, let's say, $28.28 is the charge for the water and stormwater bill. For the year 2004, it's $28.62. It went in all that time. In 8 years, it went up 40 cents. I look at today's bill, and the same bill for the same part of our utility bill is $59.50. And I'm using less water and less electricity. From $28 to $59 in just a few years, that's really exorbitant. And this shouldn't be. It's for parks. It's for recreation. It's for the homeless. Somehow, those are all causes that all of you are charged with and all of us have in our heart. They have to be paid. We should increase the funding in all ways. But let's make it a fairer tax, a tax according to the ability to pay. We don't hear about that anymore. We get these flat taxes, one after another, added to our bills. And I think it's time to stop. We have to change. We have to make a big change in our state. And maybe the state has to lead the way. Maybe the president has to lead the way. But I would really appreciate it if our city could lead the way and be a little more thoughtful. It's a tax, not a fee.
Bob Sigmund is next, followed by Jeff Lazar.
Hi, my name is Bob Sigmund. I'm in Ward 2, live in Ward 2.
Thank you for allowing me to speak tonight. I want to spend my limited time tonight to try to explain how this council and previous councils, for that matter, got us where we are today and to demonstrate why we don't need this stormwater ordinance. I've been attending city council meetings for more than 30 years. Over the last 10 or so years, it's been a constant drumbeat of no growth, slow growth, no UGB expansion. In addition, the city was very selective when it came to choosing the type of businesses that they wanted to come to Eugene. At no time did I ever hear a discussion of benefits of growth, only drawbacks. More recently, the council and mayor have been out chasing windmills. The city has spent staff time working on plastic bag ordinance, coal train resolution, and who knows what else. The city spent $2 million on a design for a new city hall. Unfortunately, those plans are now in a drawer somewhere. In addition, the city found $250,000 for a skateboard park and an equal amount of money for the homeless. The real truth is that this city always can find money when it wants to. In addition, the city has had difficulty reining in employee compensation. At a recent city club meeting, a member asked the city manager if PERS was responsibility for the city's shortfall. The city manager responded by saying PERS is a statewide issue and should be addressed in Salem. Well, I beg to differ. Contract negotiations with the various bargaining units are held right here, not in Salem. The city has yet to show any willingness to seriously engage the bargaining units. Consequently, city employee compensation, including benefits, is out of control. The city manager has been telling us that the city has a structural deficit. I think most of us in this audience know what is driving the shortfall in revenue. Could it be the current and past practices of the council, or can it be blamed solely on the economy? I believe the council majority was preoccupied with other issues and failed to see where the city was headed. Had the county been paying more attention to the basics, we wouldn't be here tonight debating the need for stormwater revenue. At this point, what are the options? This is not the time to be raising stormwater fees and creating a new city service fee. The public won't stand for more taxes and fees. Eugene voters will never support more taxes for a city hall as long as they continue to get nickel and dime for fees. Other agencies in this community are cutting back on spending, including the city of Eugene, Lane County, and even Elkhog. And while you may think that I am against all tax increases, I'm very willing to support a five-year option levy for the Lane County in May. This community needs more public safety funding, along with the ability to prosecute criminals and keep them locked up. I do agree with the city manager that we need to encourage more business development in the city. It's too bad we had to wait this long to figure out that having a job does improve one's quality of life, and jobs provide revenue for the city. Chip Kelly's new house is an excellent example of how the city's revenue can grow quickly. The city will receive over $5,000 per year as a result of construction.
Jeff Lozar is next.
Thank you.
Followed by Kathleen Gaffney.
Hello, good evening. My name is Jeff Lozar. I live on Antelope Way in Eugene, which is in Ward 4. As I mentioned, I live in Ward 4. I also run a business in Eugene, which is in Ward 7. This, of course, means I have been singled out along with many other business owners to be subject to your new tax twice over. I'm curious if that means I can vote no twice. What I have printed out for you is the results of a Register Guard poll showing your new taxes are hugely unpopular. You can find that on their website, on the Register Guard. Anyone living in the real world could tell you this. I am frankly stunned. Excuse me. Stunned by your proposed new dual tax, and wonder what kind of a bubble you must live in to even make the suggestion. Unemployment is high, the economy is low. Surely not the time to add as much as $9 million in new taxes to the city of Eugene, to the residents. I am curious what you have against business, especially ones like mine where we live and work in Eugene. Does your bubble allow you to note how many businesses have moved to Springfield? It would seem not. If I did not have such deep roots in this community, I might have already moved away. I really like living in this town, but this sort of fiscal irresponsibility is troubling. I might not be able to vote twice, but I can sure make a concerted effort to work toward defeating this tax. Just about 2 years ago, you tried to raise taxes, claiming, I believe it was, the campaign was something like For the Children. Even with that misleading title, it was defeated nearly 2-1. This time around, it will have a title more like For the Programs. And with a title like that, I think the chart I handed you is pretty accurate, what the voters would say when and if we get the chance. I know a lot of what we're talking about is programs, and so I want to be the first to volunteer. You don't need to pick up leaves for me. I have 3 very large trees in front of my house that produce huge piles of leaves. And the city comes by twice a year and picks those up. And, you know, I can do that myself. I don't need that help.
Thank you. Kathleen Gaffney is next, followed by Brian Weaver.
Kathleen Gaffney, Ward 2. Good evening, Mayor and Council. I am here tonight to bring your attention to seniors, particularly women, living on single and limited incomes. As a 71-year-old senior living on a single and limited income, your decision to levy additional taxes will have an impact on my ability to continue to own my home that I built here 10 years ago. I watched your workshop meeting on January 14th that discussed city service fees that might be imposed by the council without a vote of the residents. You presented these new fees as only another $6 to $10 per month. My property tax bill for 2012-13, and I'm more than happy to document it for you, was $4,736.61. Remember, the house was built just 10 years ago. This tax is on a 1,900 square foot modest home with no fancy marble or exotic hardwood floors. My current stormwater monthly fee is already $24.42 and costs more than the water I use. My cost of living increase of $30 from Social Security for this year will not cover the projected 1.5% property tax increases, new monthly proposed city fees of potentially $10, eWeb's increase of $8.75 increase, the tax measure you plan for the May ballot, and the looming Lane County ballot tax measure. Where does it stop? Life choices and hard work enabled me to have a home. Help me keep my home and abandon any thoughts of additional taxes and assessments to be imposed without voter consent. I limit my choices to reflect my financial reality. My generation was taught to live within its means. I ask the city to do the same. Thank you.
Brian Weaver is next, followed by Reverend Douglas W. Vaughn.
Good evening, councilors. I'm Brian Weaver, Ward 1. I oppose the stormwater fee. It's really not for stormwater. It reminds me of extortion, you know, or the Sopranos. Instead of Tony coming by and shaking me down for $10, it'll be eWeb saying, cough it up or I'll shut off your power. So, and it's really, it's been said that it's a community problem, not a city problem, but I disagree. It's a city problem, and I'll tell you why. The city's personnel costs has gone up almost twice the rate of inflation. And I've got the math here for, I got 10 copies, John, for the staff and the counselors. Anyway, and these numbers, it'll prove that if the cost increase was halved to to be just the rate of inflation, the city would be in the red. That you wouldn't be in the black, or you'd be in the black. You wouldn't be in the red if it was just halved, and they'd still get a cost of living increase, or whatever that increase is for. Seems like the city workers have been insulated from the recession by public money from the working stiff who are exposed to the effects of the recession. I know I was laid off for almost a year. I took a 5% pay cut from my employer. So another point is the city has really undermined its tax base. This is in part also created the problem by making poor decisions, interfering with free enterprise, and a general anti-business attitude or actions. This basically has driven businesses away and repelled new businesses who may have been considering relocating to Eugene. And that we lose out on jobs as well. And I want to make a comment here about the city's lack of an economic prosperity plan. The city's current regional prosperity plan is almost 3 years old, and it's nothing more. I looked at the PDF, and it's a colorful document, green borders and leaves, but there's no benchmarks in it. So, Mayor Percy, I've got to. I appreciate you being honest at the last work session on the 14th, where you said we've lost the same amount we've gained, maybe more. And also, you said for a while we did turn our faces away from economic development. So all of that is coming to a head now. That's why the revenue is down.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Reverend Douglas Vaughn is next, followed by Dennis Gabrielson.
Good evening. My name is Doug Vaughn, Reverend Vaughn by some, Doug to others. First of all, I'd like to say that I'm a native of Eugene, born and raised here, nearly approaching 60 years, but not quite there yet. George Poling is my counselor, and I'm here tonight because not only to represent my position, but the feelings of many people, citizens of Eugene, that I care for and deal with on almost a weekly basis. And this whole business over fees has got a lot of people very upset. People who are below the poverty level, at it, marginally above it, maybe even into income levels of $30,000 and $40,000 that are struggling to get by week after week. They don't know where the next money's going to come to pay the E-Web bill, the natural gas bill, food, decisions over what medicine to buy, or to go at times, as I have expressed to my counselor, to a junkyard to buy used tires so dad can go to work. And he goes to work at a job for $10 an hour, $12 an hour, and no insurance benefits. Now, as I said, and if I do not make this plan, I want to. The comments that I'm going to make may seem harsh, and I give a pass to the two new counselors, but I hope you hear my words loud and clear, because they express many citizens. The plain simple truth is this. The city of Eugene, quite frankly, has no real comprehensive leadership at this time. And you can call this a fee, an assessment, whatever you want to color it. It's a tax. And it's an end-run attempt around citizens, an end-run attempt around property taxes, and quite frankly, it's a lot of people who feel very seriously that they're tired of in-your-face government. It's time to put citizens first. instead of special interest. I have read the city budget several times, most recently, and I would agree with the city manager's assessment that the biggest single problem we face are the growing wages, PERS, insurance benefits, and so forth. And quite frankly, as many people as I deal with in Eugene, and a lot of those people are union people, they are Teamsters, they don't even have benefits close to what the city gets.
Dennis Gabrielson is next, followed by Greg Osborne.
My name is Dennis Gabrielson. I live in Creswell, Oregon, but I was born in Eugene. And I'm here to speak that for some friends of mine that can't make it here because they work nights. I agree with all the people that spoke before me. This is a tax. It's regressive. I'd like to know how much you guys spent on the public relations firm that has been putting out stuff about this. I think their company's name is Vox, something like that. Just, you know, I think it's a failure on John Reese's part to actually go through and look at who he has working in the city. I hate to disagree with some of you guys, people, but I was a city employee for 35 years. And so I am a retiree, but I don't get no exorbitant amount of money. I get what I was promised and guaranteed. There are some that got exorbitant amount of money, and I'm going to go up to the PERS board and talk to them about how to reform that, but that's another topic. And I consider all of you failures for the way you do things and the way you you spend $300,000 on the homeless to let them spend the few weeks in the park illegally. I will still say that. And I think this is just a transfer of funds from an enterprise fund to a general fund. It's creative bookkeeping, but it's not, shouldn't be legal. And I should have the attorney over here checking into that. I know you can make it sound really legal by saying, you know, stormwater is for the abatement of runoff, and parks are always gathering water. And I mean, you can always go on and on about that. It's just like city services for other things that money is transferred. It's transferred in a very inappropriate way. And that man right over there should be looking at all of it, looking at his own staff. And I'm calling his staff because I don't ever think we do need an assistant city manager when we have a manager who should be doing the work. Who's doing the work? The assistant city manager or the manager? Just a question. But this tax is very regressive. The fee, it's not. If you're going to do it, you should do it to a vote of the people and let them turn you down, instead of trying to pass it just by.
Greg Osborne is next, followed by Scott Smith.
Greg Osborne, I guess all of you are my counselor. I live at 2095 West 26th Place. I've lived in Eugene for 30 years, been involved at the university and the local education field involved. I'm proud of the city council, how hard you guys work, all the graph and all the crap you take, but I'm here in opposition to this ordinance because it's poorly written. And I'll do that simply by asking people if they have the ordinance or the proposed ordinance to look on page 6 and look at the wording on it. It's vague, it's open-ended. Pretty soon we'll be having E-Web charge me for the rainwater that falls on my roof. Pretty soon we'll be having charges for what runs off in addition to the stormwater. Well, I'm concerned that it's very open-ended. It's poorly written. My legal staff would just stick it on the ground and just shred it up, okay? So, but I do appreciate your work. I will become more involved in city council meetings, and your definite attempts to try to figure out how in the heck we're going to fill all the budget holes and keep it a nice community as it is. I've enjoyed living here, and I continue to plan to live here. I was involved in quite a bit of politics earlier on in my younger days. Now I'm not, but I will look at these ordinances in detail and make comments on them. But this one's poorly written, needs to be taken back and redrafted. Otherwise, it's going to face a whole lot of crap. Thank you.
Scott Smith is next, followed by James McCarthy.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Scott Smith. I live in Ward 5. I'm opposed to the stormwater fee. I find it to be disingenuous because it's really not about stormwater. It's about trying to fill other holes in the general fund, and I think it needs to be brought to us as that, not as a stormwater fee, because it does not appear to be about stormwater. It's time for the city of Eugene to live within its means, like the rest of us have to do. I understand there'd be difficult cuts to services, but the city of Eugene is not the only entity that's having to look at cutting services and make difficult choices. Thank you.
James McCarthy is next, followed by Diane Thurlow.
Good evening. My name is James McCarthy. I live at 468 Delwood Drive in Betty Taylor's district. I've been a resident in Eugene for 43 years, raised a family, had a business here for 27 years, proud to be a Eugene citizen and love it. Children have taken part in kids sports. They've enjoyed the facilities, the fields, and it's been a great place to raise a family. I myself, as part of a service organization, have spent hundreds, if not over 1,000 hours working on the Rose Garden over the past several years. And I understand that in the past few years we've kind of been stonewalled. We've been attempting to work at the Rose Garden and have basically been put off, that they don't want our help. I understand we're still trying to get to work in the Rose Garden and may be able to. I believe that putting this assessment on the stormwater charge is a slippery slope. I believe this is no different than what's going on in Washington, D.C. right now. I want to vote on this, and I will vote for it. I'll vote for the $10 fee. I'll be happy to pay the $10 fee for the parks. But I don't believe, what's next? Are we going to put human resources under stormwater? Are we going to put the library under stormwater? Are we going to put the IT department under stormwater? This needs to be voted on by the public. And I know the fear is the public will turn it down, and that's probably a pretty good bet. My solution is, let's have volunteers take care of the parks. Let's have the Boy Scouts adopt the park. Let's have the neighborhood in Whitaker adopt the park. Let's have the Rotary Club and Kiwanis and Lions Club adopt some parks. But let's get creative about what we can do to keep our parks. And if a neighborhood doesn't want to keep a park up, so be it. But this is a slippery slope. Thank you very much for your time.
Diane Thurlow is next, followed by Charles Hibbard.
My name is Diane Thurlow. I live at 217 Crest Drive in Eugene. These city council public meetings are the definition of crazy. Citizens come and explain to you why we don't like your proposals. You pretend to listen, and then you do whatever you darn please. Then the next time, the pattern repeats. We get it. You want as much of our money as you can possibly get. You know you can't get it all at once. You're progressives, after all, And that means you're willing to be patient, to progress. You'll take a little at a time until you have it all. I hope people who don't agree with you understand that until we vote you out of office, we have no power. I get your game. I know my choice. I can move out of Eugene so you have no access to my money, like the rich people in France are doing now. Or I and like-minded people can vote you out of office. We have a lot of socialists who live in Eugene. They keep voting for you. You're drunk with power. Therefore, for now, these meetings serve no purpose.
Charles Hibbert is next, followed by Tony Antone.
I'm Charles Hibbert. I don't live in Eugene. I live in down on River Road area. But I have a business over here, and I have a property down on West 11th. What concerns me is the people that come here and testify are the people that are capable of getting out. But I have a lot of people that are involved with it, are old age pensioners that have a home. Some lady I know's husband's passed away, and she's battling, you know, keeping the house. And I think that to put a general tax on everybody, no matter if they're old age pensioner, they're just living on a small means of income, and to take the money out of one for one designation and then move it to the parks and recreation, there's got to be a different way of doing it. It seems like a Ponzi scheme where they want to get money here and there. This is what comes to mind when I see the city council wanting to get more money. You guys just approved the EMX on the West 11th, which I don't see anything in there that's going to cover the cost of the maintenance of the roads and everything. So another few years down the road when the EMX is starting to run and the roads are starting to break apart and the city's being deteriorated by these big scheme ideas, you guys are going to come back for more money from the taxpayers. And when do you stop? You know, you guys have got to get your be a little bit tighter. In my business, a few years ago, I had employees that were earning $27 to $30 an hour, and I had 16 employees. Now I got 6 employees, and they're earning about $15 to $17 an hour. That's how the economy's gone down. But the city and the government people tend to be just living it up, you know? And somewhere there's got to be a way to pay for these parks without taking money from this side and putting it on that side and trying to, I don't know how to say it, but trying to lie to the customers, indirectly not doing what, it's just not, something smells bad about it. So, thanks.
Tony Antone is next, followed by Bonnie Bettman McCornick.
Tony Antone. I live in Eugene. I've lived here my whole life. I've watched the agencies grow, the empire being built, spend. We don't have a money problem. We have a spending problem that nobody up there, nobody anywhere in this government seems to want to address. I don't know how I have the right to sit home on my lazy boy, drink a beer and watch a football game while you're here spending my money and my kids' money and the people out there that don't have even a roof over their head right now. And you want to fund lavish lifestyles and employees' benefits and compensation packages that the free market just can't afford. But you don't live in the real world. You have your own world that you've created for yourself, an economy within an economy. I was at one of your offices one day. I'm going to share a story. I was at an office, and I was waiting for one of the people to help me. And there was a woman there working at a file cabinet. And I asked her, so what do you do? And she says, well, I'm a customer service analyst. I said, customer service analyst? You have a monopoly. Now, what in the world would you care about customer service for? And she looks at me a little snooty now, and she says, well, I think every business should have a customer service analyst. I said, well, there's two things wrong with that. First of all, you don't run a business. You have a monopoly. Second of all, and more importantly, I do have a customer service analyst. It's called the free market. And if my customers don't call me back, my service just got analyzed. And that cuts down on the overhead. And it's a great system. And I love America, and I love Eugene. I've been here my whole life. Please get out of our way and let us build this business and let us build our community back again.
We don't do that. We try to have a respectful environment here where everybody can be heard and everybody treats each other well, and we don't clap and boo or do any of those things. Bonnie Bettman McCormick is next. Welcome back to our former counselor, Bonnie Bettman. And Dennis Cassidy is next.
Good evening. I'm Bonnie Bettman McCormick. The rich are still getting richer while everyone else is getting poorer, and both the city's proposed fees advance that paradigm. I strongly oppose both fees. I will only address the council-imposed fee for this public record. This current financial crisis is the latest version of what has been a perpetual financial crisis over decades. No matter how much the city has, they always think they need more. I have seen how the city spends money and wastes money and gives it away. The city has options besides burdening hardworking and struggling Eugene residents with more taxes. The Oregon State Statute says tax means a charge imposed by a governmental entity for the purpose of generating revenues for governmental purposes. The city manager's proposal to remove the parks and recreation budget out of the general fund and into the stormwater management program is nothing more than a huge $4.5 million tax increase masquerading as a fee. Changes in stormwater fees notwithstanding, $4.5 million is just for the council-imposed fee and does not even include the May ballot measure. This proposal is a regressive flat tax, which is egregiously more burdensome to low- and middle-income residents than large businesses or wealthy residents. If you are a grandmother on a fixed income living in a tiny apartment, you are charged the same as a wealthy householder in a 7-bedroom, 5-bath house. Regional non-Eugene residents who regularly enjoy Eugene's park system program services, open space, and natural areas will pay nothing at all. This so-called fee will be used for government services that are currently paid with general fund revenue from property taxes. Eugene residents pay for park services with their property taxes, which are deductible. Fees taxpayers pay for government services are not deductible. The existing rationale for charging the current stormwater fees has a weak but viable justification. That justification disappears with the proposed expansion of the fees to include parks and rec. Currently, the stormwater fees are rationalized because the piping and channeling of runoff is comparable to a utility like wastewater management. Opportunistically tying the cost of parks maintenance and operation to what is essentially a use or consumption fee is an obvious deceit and sets a dangerous precedent. If this new taxing authority is exercised, there will result a proliferation of unilaterally imposed fees by claiming any illusory nexus to utility-based services. Expanded taxing authority through fees, in other words, being able to raise taxes with the stroke of a pen, will provide city government with unlimited access to Eugene residents' wallets.
Dennis Cassidy is next, followed by Vicki Mello.
My name is Dennis Cassidy. I live in Ward 2 and I'm a lifetime resident of Eugene. I'd just like to state I'm against this proposed fee. Everybody in this room here has to live within a budget means, and I think the city should be living within their means, not just trying to tax additional to support. I don't know of anybody that I've yet to run across anybody that has a money tree in their backyard. So I just like to state that this is a burden for everyone. It increases the cost of housing for everyone and may cause people to move outside the city limits of Eugene and into possibly the River Road area or Springfield. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Vicki Mello is next, followed by Douglas Moorhead.
Good evening. Thank you for letting me speak. My name is Vicki Mello, and I live at Eastwood Lane. I'm in George Poling's ward. I am the chair of the Citizens Planning Committee of the Willamette Natural Area of Alton Baker Park, but I'm speaking for myself at this public hearing. I only mentioned the CPC for you to know that I do volunteer and work within the parks, within the Willamette Natural Area. I volunteered at work parties in other parks like Skinner Butte Park, Oakmont Park, and Hendricks Park. I think volunteers are a vital part of our park system, but they cannot provide the resources to fix broken or well-worn infrastructure like bridge railings, fill cracks in paved paths, upgrade water features like we have at the River Play Park in Skinner's Butte. The majority of Eugene voters approved a bond measure in the past to fund city parks, and I think parks are really important. Eugene is known for the wonderful park systems we have. Parks and Open Spaces has done a great job with the limited amount of funding over the last couple of years that has slowly been taken away and staff drastically reduced. So I think we need parks for healthy living and to provide a great learning environment for our children to learn stewardship of green areas. I am in the minority here, I guess. I do support this fund, and I'd be willing to pay up to $10 a month for it. I think the park systems that we have are a good representation of what we hold dear within the city of Eugene. Open spaces are important. We need to have spaces other than paved roads and lots of structures. So I am in support, and I hope that we can find park maintenance dollars again in order to do what needs to be fixed. Thank you.
Douglas Moorhead is next, followed by Nick Erhausen.
My name is Douglas Moorhead. I live in the Prairie Street Bridge area, and I'm one of the owners of a business in the River Road area. I'd like to point out something that in reading your ordinance is the rationale for the ordinance is the poor economy. And the second thing that is listed is that it needs stable funding. I believe that probably this ordinance is going to pass, but I would encourage that the stormwater fees and the park fees be separated. I think it's a little bit deceptive to start lumping things together. And if the rationale is it's because it's a poor economy, I would recommend that there be, in 2 years, that this whole issue be revisited. So that, because I really believe that parks, and most of, as it was pointed out, it's not a utility service. Parks, like anything else, should be competing for general funds. The idea of insulating a city service by providing, quote, stable funding reminds me of how it is that we have to deal with E-Web, where we have some large commission. I mean, the fees are just increased. We have absolutely no control. The politicians are insulated because, well, the you have bureaucracy that's taking care of all that stuff. It's out of politics at that point. So if this is going to come forward and be passed, I think it should be separated. There should be a limited time period in which it should be revisited when supposedly the economy is going to come back. And I think otherwise there's just going to show that there's just a lot of deception in this move by the city.
Nick Erhausen is next, followed by Laura Fenimore.
My name is Nick Erhausen, 3058 Hawkins Lane. I've been coming here for about 30 years off and on, sometimes more often, sometimes less often. However, it's the first time I can remember in 30 years that I agreed completely with Ruth Dummler and Bonnie Bettman. Completely. Like they say, this tax is not, it's kind of like we paid the tax already, and then PERS has kind of come and helped themselves to what money you had, and now you want us to pay it a second time, except that this is not tax deductible even, so it's a full, it comes out of take-home pay. It kind of reminds me, it smells like an E-Web hearing, where they've already decided before they have the hearing what the new fee is going to be. And then we have a hearing, and then they vote in it, you know, because it's not subject to anything the voters can do. I would be happy with anything you put on the ballot, because if you can get it on the ballot and get it passed, more power to you. Now, to me, the stormwater fee, I remember when it started, that seemed like a gimmick to me as to begin with. But it's Eugene, and I said, okay, it's not that much money every month. Now, this seems like you're putting a gimmick on top of a gimmick. Because there's really no connection with the stormwater fee and the parks. Now, as far as the president, we'd all love to have an Obama-style budget where you can spend $1 trillion more than you take in. But you can't have, you don't have printing presses, so you have to live with what the circumstances are. So you may have to just learn to live within your means, make do like people do, because there's a shrinking economic pie here, and it seems like you want to not only keep the share you got, but you want to get a little bigger. Meanwhile, there's a lot of people out here that, you know, are suffering. You know, if you really want more money, you should need to invest in more growth. I know there's a couple new houses going in my neighborhood, so maybe that, you know, you need to grow your budget along with the growth in the general population and in the local economy. But remember, I mean, our current city manager wasn't here at the time, but we chased away a perfectly good hospital that didn't need to happen. And I'm sure they're paying some hefty tax bill now that we're not getting. So we're the best thing ever happened to Springfield, but other than that, I'll let Laura talk to you someone. Thank you.
Laura Fenimore is next, followed by Jen Perry.
Hi, my name is Laura Cooper Fenimore, and I live at 808 Lariat Drive in Eugene. I'm going to keep this pretty short and sweet. I don't have a lot to say. The big issue for me is rule of law. I think this is a deceptive proposal. I think people who citizens don't mind paying taxes for real things when the taxes are fair and honest and spent the way they're promised. I don't think this is going to be spent the way it's promised now or in the future, because I don't think the way that it's written is tied down enough that it can ever be that way. I don't think it's dedicated to stormwater. I don't think it has anything to do with what you say it does. I think it has to do with filling holes inside Eugene's general fund budget. And in fact, that's my other issue. I've noticed that in the city of Eugene, dollars are very fungible. Things that might be raised for one thing get moved to another thing. And it's really hard for me to justify coughing up one more dollar of my very, very fixed income in order to support a city that continues to grow, even when its own economy is, by its own admission, failing. So until you're down to your last dollar that you can't strip away, and I don't see that happening, I don't think you should be taking one more out of an economy that's failing. Thank you.
Jen Perry is next, followed by Bob Maccheroni.
Good evening. My name is Jennifer Perry. My husband has been out of work for over 2 years, almost 2 years and 5 months. We just received our latest D-Web bill. We run no heat in our house except in our bathroom. and it was over $265. Now you're telling me I'm going to pay another 10 or 20 bucks more a month? I'm going to have eWeb shutting me off because I can't pay the bill. He makes less than $300 a week right now on unemployment because it's been cut. I'm going to end up in your homeless village. Eugene is dying a very slow and painful death, and by adding more fees being convoluted as more taxes being convoluted as fees, you're just killing Eugene even quicker. And saying eWeb is a tax collector is like saying the IRS is our healthcare organization. It's ridiculous, and we have to stop. I have to live within a budget, so should you.
Last up is Bob Maccheroni.
Bob Maccheroni, I live in Eugene, and I own a business here. Most of you know that. What I'd like to tell you is that the bills that I pay this year that say taxes on the top of them, just the ones that say taxes, the ones you actually disclose as taxes, are $19,000. That's what I have to pay this year. And so I know all of you are thinking, wow, he must be really, really rich here. And you're right. I live less than a half a mile from Chip Kelly's house in a 1,200-square-foot house. And I drive a 13-year-old car that has 160,000 miles. And there's a reason for that. I live within my means. And I don't believe this city does. I listen to all the plans for spending more money and spending more money and spending more money. You want a new city hall. You want something else. You always have the wants. You actually rented space that you don't use. You guaranteed that contract for 10 years. And yet you want a new city hall. Okay. I think that's ridiculous. I think you're all crazy. You got a new logo, get a new attitude. Live within your means. That should be your new motto. Now, you have these fees coming, and you admit there's a $6 million shortfall. Why are you asking for 25% more money? Why are you looking for $7.5 million? Because you already spent the money. And so we all know that this is a way to neutralize voters' rights, is to pass this fee. That's what you're doing. That's all you're doing. I pay it four times over. I have a storage building that has two water meters. I get to pay on both of those. I have my 1,200-square-foot house. I pay on that one. I have my main business building. I pay on that one. So this is a nearly $1,000 fee to me this year. That's on top of my $19,000 I already paid. That's on top of the 5-cent city gas tax. When does it end? When is it enough for you guys? When do you actually see that you're killing businesses, you're driving everybody out of town that has lived here and has built this town? When is it enough? When do you write a city ordinance that actually benefits the citizens instead of the city? When is that time coming? Please tell me that. And that's all we're asking you to do, is quit spending our money. Cut some administrators. I don't want you to cut the policeman. I don't want you to cut the guy that fills the pothole. I don't want you to cut the guy that is actually providing the service. Do you think the city manager is going to tell you I got too many administrators and that I need to cut 10 or 20% of them? I doubt that'll ever happen. But that's what I do at my business. Can I cut the guy that's going to actually repair your car? I certainly can. He's my revenue guy. The reason I'm in business.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Close the hearing. Ask council if you have any comments or questions.
I'll jump in there.
Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mayor. Thanks, everyone, for coming and sharing your opinions. I can't predict how council is going to vote next week on the ordinance, and I don't want to predict how the potential ballot measure is going to turn out, but I just like to share with you that if we don't raise revenues approximately $7.5 million, of services will either be seriously reduced or eliminated entirely. So I've heard some good ideas here, so I think what I'd like to encourage you all to do is send me a list, send the council a list, make it add up to $7.5 billion of services that you feel you can live without, and another component of the list could be efficiencies that the city could find, and just make it add up to $7.5 million. I'd love to see it. And I'm being sincere when I say this. I'm not being sarcastic. I'd like to get other ideas. PERS has to be done at the state level. I'm sorry that that can't be done between now and July 1st. We can't do a total PERS reform. So please, I invite you to do that. I kind of like the idea of more volunteering in the parks. I do that with a group that wants to save Civic Stadium, and we go and we have cleanups, and we have weed pulling parties, and we have kept the place from looking derelict. It hasn't been used for 3.5 years. It actually looks pretty nice. So I kind of like that idea. Please send us your ideas. Thanks.
Councilor Poling.
Well, I'd like to start off by saying I've been called a lot of things in my life, but I've never been called a progressive. That's kind of a shock to me. Anyway, Bonnie, it was good to see you again. And like Mr. Erhausen, I agree with what you said. And you and I differed quite a bit in the years that we were both on the council. One of the things that I've always said at the start of each budget process, I directed a question, at what point do we keep cutting a program? Does it no longer function? If it get to that point, shut that program down. And I think that's what we need to do. We need to go in and we need to look at all the different programs that we've been whittling away over the years and find the efficiency level, and if it's not there, shut that program down. Another thing is that I've always discussed is, why can't we do an adopt the park program to get neighborhoods involved in taking care of the parks in their areas? The other thing that I've really pushed for, and I've gotten a lot of pushback in previous years, is a consolidated effort or consolidation of services by not only the city of Eugene and Lane County, but let's get Springfield involved in that. A good example is road building. Granted, there are different standards on how you build a road inside the city and how you build one out in the county, but the equipment is the same, the technology is the same, it's just the design. We need to start looking at how to consolidate some of the work that's being done countywide. When I worked for the sheriff's office, the reports that we use now, I retired in 2001. The report forms that we used and the report forms that EPD used, the only difference was at the top where it said Lane County Sheriff's Office or Eugene Police Department. Why can't we consolidate the records departments? So there's some things that we need to look at. Also, we need to get back and set our priorities to basic core functions: police, fire, EMS, public works, which includes the transportation infrastructure, and economic development. Without economic development, you can't fund anything. Without businesses coming in, without local businesses expanding, you're not going to get an increase in your tax base. I was having a discussion with my wife, who works for the county as the economic development manager. There is some improvement in that. There are some other businesses looking at our communities, or some local businesses are looking at expanding. So there is a kind of an upswing in the local economic development, not only here locally, but statewide also. So there is some hope there, but that's going to be down the road a ways. It's not going to happen overnight. So I think if we get back to those four basic core functions and start cutting out some of the other projects or programs, rather, that aren't quite making it, I think we can work our way out of this. But at this point, you know, this... Am I over? Uh-huh. Sorry.
Councilor Evans.
Thanks, Mayor. And I want to thank everyone who's come out and testified tonight on this particular proposal. One of the things, there's several things on my list that more than concern me about this. One is that this community is going to be facing several money measures on the May ballot. We have a jail that absolutely has to be funded, or we will only have 29 beds where we can house people who commit the most heinous crimes in this community. That's unacceptable. That is absolutely unacceptable to me. It's the only measure that I can see supporting at this point in time. This is absolutely a regressive measure and proposal, and I said this at a work session earlier. I have a woman to the left of me who just sold her house. I have a woman to the right of me that sold her house because their incomes can't keep pace with their expenses. And if we add another $240 to our tax bill, then I'm going to have a few more people that are going to be selling their house and moving in with their children because they can't afford to operate and maintain their own homes. There were several questions that I didn't get answered at the work session. One of those was, if we impose this fee, the stormwater fee, and then the other $10 on top of that, and we're asking eWeb to administer it, one, somebody should talk to eWeb if that's the case, because apparently the eWeb commissioners that I've spoken to about it haven't been consulted about it. The other thing is that it costs money to administer these fees. It costs money to collect these fees. We just went through a 4% increase on our eWeb bill, and I understand at some point Bonneville Power is going to raise the rates that they charge to eWeb again, and our bill is going to, it's going to just get passed on to us. It's not going to be absorbed by the utility. So we are going to be facing some really draconian situations when it comes to just trying to get by. And with all due respect, Councilor Brown, I can predict how the people in my ward will vote. Nobody showed up tonight to testify, but I know that they will not support this, and I won't support it either.
Councilor Surratt.
So thanks, everyone who came out to speak, and also folks who've submitted comments via email. And, you know, I think there are some very valid critiques of this approach for collecting new money and, you know, including the fact that it hits people of fixed incomes, that it can't be deducted the way a payroll tax could be. You know, my understanding is the city is limited in how it can look for new taxes, and yes, it would be a tax. I don't think we were trying to fool anybody by calling it a fee. I think that's really just technical term for it. And I'm sorry that some people are offended that we would even bring this up, but, you know, my feeling is that considering what we're facing in terms of our fiscal circumstances, it would be irresponsible for us not to have the conversation. So you're helping us engage in the conversation, which is really important, and I appreciate that you've done that and came out to share that with us. I do tend to agree with Councillor Brown that we are facing some you know, we've been hearing folks tonight say tighten our belts. Well, that may be exactly what happens, and that there will be city services that will be cut. And some of you in this room may not notice that, but other folks in this community will. So this isn't about us on this council asking you for more money. It's about us trying to find a way forward for this community. And if that means we have to live within tighter means than what we're imagining, then we'll figure that out and we'll do that. So I really appreciate everyone who's given input on this vital question. I think it's really important. We are struggling as a council how to move forward, and I would say to you, do not presuppose how we're going to vote on this, because I don't think it's settled at all. So I really appreciate your input this evening. Thanks so much.
I join council in thanking you all for coming. The only other comments that – oh, go ahead, Betty. I'll finish up after you.
Thank you. I think that we do need more income in the city, but I think this is the wrong way to get it. As far administration, I just wanted to point out that the assistant city manager is doing two jobs at the present time, and I think there have been a lot of cuts in personnel, and that people are working very hard. But I think that putting something on the utility bill is the wrong thing to do. I think people might lose a good way to make more homeless people is to have people have their utilities cut off, which would happen if they didn't pay their bill, and then have to pay an extra fee to reinstate them, and then pay an extra month's fee before they can get it. It's just the wrong thing to do. I think that we need to. There should be a way. We haven't really discussed different ways of. We've been told some ways that we might get more income, but we haven't had a serious discussion. There should be a way to get money from people who use our parks, our roads, all of our services, and do not live here and do not pay taxes here. There should be a way to do that. If we're going to have another tax, I would think a surcharge on high incomes would be a good way. But there are a lot of people who are barely getting by, barely paying for their necessities. And I think putting something on a utility bill is really the wrong way to go about it. I would be interested in hearing from people what services you would like to see cut, and what if your ideas for more income for the city, which I do think is needed. Thank you.
So we've said this a number of times, but I think it bears repeating tonight. First of all, I just want to say that from our staff point of view, we have not said to them we want to cut any particular service or part of the city. So and from their perspective, they have to try to find a way to pay for what we're asking them to pay for. So that's they came to us with some suggestions for how they thought that might be done. They also have spent 4 years cutting and pulling the belt into us, practically coming out their backs. They've cut $24 million out of our $125 million general fund. And we have 100 less employees in the city. And we've done innovative things like a partial merger of fire departments, database policing, volunteers in our parks and all over the place. So there's been a huge effort to, and we have lived within our means. We have to balance the budget every time. So we have lived within our means. It's just the point right now that I think council is trying to have with you is given the services level that we have, we can't even reach providing those services that we have unless we add some revenue. And so that's the discussion, and you've been asked to participate in it. We heard what you had to say. We're hearing from people all over the city. We've asked, done a couple surveys where people have said they might, would be willing to pay a little more to keep the services we have. So trying to determine the best way to do that. And so that's the discussion. Thank you for being here and participating in that. We heard a lot of important things today. Chris.
Thank you, Mayor. I guess since everybody else spoke, I'll do a little bit. I appreciate everybody coming out, and one of the challenges, and I hear what you're saying, and as it's been said, this is obviously not a done deal by any means, and there's a lot of conversation that needs to go on. I've heard some folks say, we need to learn, like my family does, to live within our means, and that means a lot to me. I'm in a family, and we have to live within our means. Part of the challenge we have, though, is in many of your families, it's four people, five people with adults, and those people get to make the decision. Our family is 160,000 adults. And so it's very difficult to try to say, what does our family want to do to live in its means when you have 160,000 adults? Now, many of those adults will stay in the room and they won't participate in the discussion about living within our means. But there are many thousands of adults living in our family who do want to be involved in the discussion about living within our means. You can see that that makes our conversation about living within our means more complicated. And no one group of adults within our family gets to decide what living in our means means. In fact, if you sit and watch the nine of us sitting up here, just in the course of tonight, you've heard us kind of come up with different ways of how we could live within our means. So when Councillor Brown or someone else here says, tell us your ideas. I do think that is sincere. You don't have to shout them out tonight, but I do think send them to us and tell us, as members of our family, what kind of ideas do you think we could use to be able to live more effectively within our means? We do not want to sound like we are threatening anybody, because that doesn't ever lead anyone anywhere.
But after 4 years of $24 million worth of cuts, we probably are looking at making some real functional departmental cuts. And if our family says that's what we need to do, that's what our family will do. But I don't know if our family is in total agreement, which leads me to my final point, where I would agree with you. The family needs to operate democratically. And so if the family is going to make a decision, the family needs to make it. And the best way to do that is for the family to vote. And so I think the notion of how we operate probably needs to be something that we do collectively. I'm resistant to the ideas of doing things unilaterally. And so I think we need to reconsider how those different things might work. But please, we're not doing this just for us. I don't get a big paycheck. I don't get a lavish lifestyle. I'm really doing this because I want to be a member of this family, and I know that you do too. So let's work as hard as we can to try to do this as thoughtfully as we can. I'll work with you because I know you want to work with us. We'll do it together. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on to the next public hearing. The next public hearing is an ordinance concerning prohibited uses and special use limitations in the nodal development overlay zone in downtown. City Manager.
Thank you, Mayor. This public hearing is on a single code amendment to allow drive-through as permitted use downtown in the nodal development overlay zone under certain circumstances. This amendment was identified through Envision Eugene in an effort to facilitate desired dense development in the downtown core along key commercial corridors. Although other potential amendments were also identified, this code amendment has been pulled forward since it is needed for the redevelopment of the courthouse property for the Northwest Community Credit Union.
Thank you. I'm going to open the public hearing, and we have six people signed up. First is Laura Potter, then it's Dave Hauser.
Good evening. My name is Laura Potter. I'm here tonight to speak on behalf of the Eugene Area Chamber of Commerce in support of the ordinance amending the nodal development overlay zone to allow drive-throughs in the downtown. The Chamber supports this amendment for several reasons, most notably because it allows the necessary flexibility to attract financial institutions into our downtown core. I think when this nodal zone was put into place, the intention was to keep single-story, single-use drive-throughs out of the downtown, things like coffee car or drive-through coffee, uses that were not dense enough for the kind of development we want to see in our downtown. An unintended consequence of this has been making it more difficult for certain businesses than to be in our downtown, and these are businesses we want to see, such as financial institutions. The proposed Northwest Community Credit Union headquarters is a perfect example of this. This project embodies exactly the kind of development we want in our downtown core. It continues to connect downtown to the river. It brings 200 employees into our downtown core. It's an owner-occupied development, and it's not seeking tax exemptions. Amending the code to allow for the drive-through is necessary for this project, but it's also good for the future development in the downtown and along the Franklin Corridor. Thank you.
Dave Hauser is next, followed by Scott Sanders.
Mayor, Council, Dave Hauser. I live at 2168 Elkhorn Drive in Councilor Clark's ward. Thank you for the opportunity to comment on the proposed land use code amendments regarding drive-through facilities in the nodal development overlay zone. You know, when you've been around the community and in the job that I have at the Chamber as long as I have, some of these issues get to come around again. We did a lot of work in the land use code update process a number of years ago. And among our comments at the time was that the expansion of the prohibition of drive-through restaurants and drive-through uses in the nodal development overlay zone to encompass any use was a misstep. We suggested at the time that the sort of one-size-fits-all standard might create some unintended consequences, such as making it more difficult for financial institutions to locate in our core or discouraging investment in our downtown. So we were really encouraged as part of the Envision Eugene process when one of the goals was to remove barriers to development that in the work plan considered adding flexibility to the nodal development overlay zone. So we very much support the proposed amendment. We believe it's modest timely and important. And as mentioned, it facilitates the expansion into our core of a great homegrown company with 200 jobs, something we all want to see and something that's an important part of the financial strategy that you were discussing earlier this evening. I was reflecting earlier today, I can't remember the last time that we've had an owner-occupied office building constructed in our core. I think you might have to go back to the U.S. Bank building in the mid-90s or early 90s as the last time that happened. So I think taking this modest step to facilitate this great addition to our downtown by this really good homegrown company makes a great deal of sense and is an important part of what many people ask you to do today, which is help grow our tax base by encouraging investment in our community. Thank you.
Scott Sanders is next, followed by Gary Wildish.
Thanks for allowing me to speak. Scott Sanders, live in Eugene, Councillor Stretchford. I'm going to just echo some of the things that are already said. I'm here to speak in support of the proposed Northwest Community Credit headquarters and the code amendment to allow that. When we think about Envision Eugene and what the community has said it wants, this is a perfect fit. This project would build on the momentum that we see downtown and also help connect it to the river as well as the eWeb master plan. It'd bring 200 employees downtown, provide additional tax revenue, help with some of the earlier issues we were discussing. It doesn't require any tax incentives, which I know the council has struggled with other projects in recent past. So what they do need is a code amendment allowing for a drive-up window. I believe this restriction was originally put in place to prevent fast food, coffee kiosks, and the like. I don't believe the code was developed to stop this kind of development and don't see how allowing them a drive-through would impact the feel and the desired outcome of the area. So don't let a small code amendment stand in the way of a great project. I urge you to do what's necessary to keep this project moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Gary Wildish is next, followed by Rex Fox.
Good evening, Gary Wildish. This is a lot more fun to talk about, wouldn't you think?
Yeah.
This is exciting. I've got a little investment with working on the Envision Eugene, working on this other little topic you're going to discuss here in a month or so called the eWeb Master Plan and the West Eugene Collaborative. For the last 6 or 7 years, I've been involved in things happening in Eugene. Well, I got to admit, they haven't moved as fast as I would like. But here's an opportunity. This is what we were talking about. This is what we have been talking about, and I hope this is what we're going to be talking about. Because this is an opportunity, an owner-occupied building who's got the financing to go ahead and do it. Doesn't have to wait on something else. He can go ahead and do it. These folks can do it. It's been decades since we've had this type of an opportunity within our core area. The other thing that's exciting about this is the location is kind of in the path of moving our core to connect with the river. And as you know, we've talked about that for years. And this fits. And so these amendments that are being requested, that you're looking at adopting, are consistent with the conversations that we've had in Envision Eugene. They're consistent with the ways that we talked about, let's see what we can do to help owners and developers move their projects ahead for the benefit of this community. This is what you're doing here. So I encourage you to look at this and support these amendments. Thank you.
Rex Fox is next, followed by Kim Woodward.
Hi. I'm Rex Fox. I live at 650 Kingswood Avenue in Betty Taylor's ward. And I come to you tonight asking for your support of the downtown mixed-use code amendment, most specifically to allow us to include a drive-up for our branch that will be part of a roughly 68,000 square foot building. As proposed, a two-lane drive-up plus a possible third lane for bikes and pedestrians will be a small component of the entire project, but being able to provide drive-up services for our members is essential. Without it, it is likely we will move to another part of town, quite possibly the outskirts rather than the core. I'm speaking as a 35-year employee of the credit union. Our primary focus is our members, and our members want drive-up options. Many people use electronic services like online banking, ATMs, and debit cards, but there are transactions that are handled more comfortably in person. That's why we still have branches. Some of these transactions can be handled more efficiently through a drive-up lane, or in the case of parents with children sleeping in car seats, the only practical option is a drive-up, especially if it's raining. I'm sure many of you people here can relate to this. As a year-round bicycle commuter, I also appreciate drive-up services, so I don't have to dig out my lock, remove my helmet and gloves, just to handle a simple transaction. Allow us to have a drive-up and everyone wins. The city of Eugene gets a solid employer in the downtown area, by the way, that is moving from the gateway area instead of to the gateway area, as has been the trend. The credit union scores a high visibility support center and branch, and our members win by having a centrally located facility in which to do business. And the community, maybe even the city council, wins too, because we plan to include a community room that could be made available for medium-sized groups, as we currently do in our gateway facility. Thanks for considering this proposed code amendment. Bringing Northwest community to downtown for Eugene will be good for everyone involved. Thank you.
Last up, Kim Woodward.
Wow, that was almost... We took that corner a little fast. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kim Woodward, and I am a resident of Eugene, and I work for Northwest Community Credit Union. And I wanted to come here tonight to just talk to you about us, again, being a local credit union that's been in business for over 60 years here in this area. And I want to ask that you consider approving the Nodal Development Code Amendment. We're committed to building our new headquarters and branch in downtown location. And remember, we have volunteer board members that serve, and they're really wanting to be a part of the community and helping, expand the downtown core of Eugene. We find that this code barrier, it is a barrier for us to build downtown. And so we want you to take that into consideration, because we want to be a part of, making Eugene a great downtown core. If we build, we anticipate bringing approximately 250 jobs to the downtown core over the next 5 years. We're experiencing our members are really responding well to our credit union and really using our services. So who knows, how big we're going to grow. And we want to be, we want Eugene to be where our headquarters is for supporting our branch network, which is branches all over the state. In smaller communities that serve our members. The new location will encourage members and employees to ride bikes, walk, and take public transportation to our facility. And we feel that the drive-through is an essential part of that service, because the reason that people choose to do business with Northwest Community is really our value proposition, which, we make things easy and delightful for them. And it's really easy if you can use a drive-up, and we've seen it over and over in all our communities that that's something that members want. And like Rex said, there's online services, but when you really want to talk to somebody, you want to come and see them face-to-face, or at least through a drive-through. So that's an important part for us. Our members have asked for it, and we want to be able to allow them to do that. One thing is, considering small children, mothers have to, or fathers have to pull up and, tote everybody inside the building. That's hard sometimes. Makes it easier for them to do a transaction quick and easy, because we know that banking is a transaction. It's not something that, we want to spend all of our time doing. And then level, I, as a disabled person, find it really convenient to have a drive-through. In fact, you know, a lot of times I choose the businesses because of that. And I know some of our elderly members that have mobility issues as well, you know, find that really helpful. And the people that care for them, because they don't have to, you know, put them in a wheelchair and, you know, bring them in. The drive-through also...
Thank you.
Thank you.
Close the public hearing. Thank everyone for their for coming and comments, and ask council if they have any comments or questions. Seeing none, I think we're going to move on to the next item.
That was easy.
Thank you all. Thank you. So here, public hearing number 3 is a quasi-judicial hearing. So those wish to speak during this public hearing should have already submitted a completed request to speak form to the information desk. Do any counselors need to disclose any conflicts of interest or ex parte contacts? Being none? Okay. City manager, would you please introduce the topic and state the approval criteria?
I will. This is a public hearing on an alley vacation request for the portion of West 4th Alley located between 4th and 5th Avenues and Lincoln and Charnelton Streets. Draft findings related to the public interest are included in the council packet as part of Attachment B. City Council will address approval criteria from Eugene Code 9.8725 in making this decision, which states in part that the vacation can be approved if the council finds that approval of the vacation is in the public interest.
Okay. So on my script now, it talks about all the order that we have all the people speak in, pro, con, neutral, but we only have one person. So I think I don't have to do that. So I'm just going to call that the make sure I open the public hearing officially, and I'm going to ask the one speaker to come up, Cheryl Monson.
Hi, I'm Cheryl Monson, and I'm representing CSA Oregon, which is the applicant, and I've worked for them for over 15 years, so I'm very familiar with them, and C.B. Simons. He's owned those properties for 30 years and have made such amazing changes and contributions to that neighborhood, and you've got all the information on the application. I really can't add anything, but I guess, here if you have any questions on the matter, and we sincerely hope and expect that you will agree and we'll decide to accept our request, adopt city staff recommendations, and approve vacation of the alley by the ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you. So are there any questions that councilors wish to ask of staff? George. Councilor Brown, excuse me.
Thank you, Mayor. How common is it for the city to sell an alley to somebody because of a few vagrants wandering in the alley? That seems to be the main reason for this vacation request.
We can get information to you when this comes back for action about how many times the council has vacated alleys or rights of way, and give you information about why that was done.
That would be good. I'm familiar with some of them from the time that I've been on council. The one for the arena, that made sense to me. The one for the Eugene Hotel, so that they could create entrances that still allowed fire access and, you know, emergency vehicle access. Is the idea of this one like a totally close off the alley entirely and then control it with a gate or something for deliveries?
So the applicant would be able to, my name is Steve Oakes, the planning department. The applicant would be able to limit access, but there would be a public utility easement retained over the alley, so there would still be the need for utility providers to be able to access the alley, but they could limit access somewhat.
Okay. Now I'm just kind of having a hard time with this one. I can't think of any, I can think of all kinds of alleys downtown where probably there's even bigger problems than what they're experiencing, and nobody's requesting that they be, get a chance to buy them and block them off from undesirables. So I'm kind of having a hard time with this one. Thank you.
Councilor Poling?
That alley currently is blocked off to through traffic on the east end of it right now. Is that correct? As far as vehicle traffic?
I am not certain of that. The applicant may be able to answer that on they have a rebuttal period, so I don't know if the applicant can answer that.
Okay. And then, in kind of follow up on what Councilor Brown was asking, can you also kind of give us at a later time, a list of any restrictions or the requirements or anything that gives us an idea if the city wants to sell this an alley like this, vacate the alley like this, are there any restrictions on the criteria on the need to sell it or the request to sell it by the buyer or anything of that nature? Just kind of give us the guidelines that are followed. Thank you.
Okay, so I anybody have any? Oh, I've got Councillor Surrett and Councillor Taylor. Councillor Surrett.
Yeah, I appreciate Councillor Brown's question about just the kind of history of the city selling public right of way. I definitely have concerns about a precedent of selling public right of way, but when I read what came in our packet on this, it made a lot of sense to me that this particular alley would. Basically, it's a funnel right out of the jail, and with all the releases that have happened, particularly in the last 6 months, I'm sure there's a steady stream of traffic down that alley. And I occasionally walk my dogs all the way over to Lincoln. I haven't gone all the way to the other side of Tarleton there, but you can also see the trash that people leave as they're leaving the jail and unpacking their belongings that they've been given and plastic bags being strewn on the ground. So, I would be inclined to support this proposal, but I do want to kind of get some context for how the city has approached these requests in the past.
Councillor Taylor?
Thank you. I saw one email, someone asked if we're going to sell an alley, why don't we give other people a chance to bid on it? Is that possible? Has that ever been done?
It's not possible. You are not actually selling the alley. What you are doing is vacating the city's interest in it. So an alley is a right-of-way, and when you buy property, it's like a bundle of sticks, and you own most of the sticks, but the right-of-way that's part of your property is owned by the city. When you vacate it, state law says it has to go back to the adjacent property because that's where the city got that stick. So you have the choice as to whether you vacate it or not. You don't have a choice as to who gets it. It goes to the adjacent property owners, and they have to pay for it.
Thank you.
I guess my question, manager, somebody, is there any public purpose for that alley that we have?
Currently, the only purpose is primarily for utilities. C.B. Simons owns the entire block, so they do use the alley for access. But for public purpose, it's primarily for utilities at this point, which will be retained by the public utility easement.
Is there any such thing as a time-limited vacation?
If by that, do you mean that the
You might say that for the next couple years or something, you would vacate your
temporary
vacation as opposed to a permanent vacation.
No.
Okay.
If the city gives up its property interest, it's as if you sold it, and you're not, again, you're not selling it, but you are giving it back to the property owner. They're paying you the value for it.
Okay. Councillor Evans.
Just to kind of wrap my head around this a little bit, the way that I viewed this when I read this the other night was that much like my tree lawn is, public property that is, owned by the city, but I have to maintain it. If this vacation is, approved by council, who's going to maintain that right-of-way? Will the adjacent property owner be responsible for maintaining that right-of-way, or will the city be responsible? And what's the kind of the division of responsibility in that situation?
If the council decides to vacate, then the city would no longer have any interest in that property except for whatever easements we have for utilities going through there. There's no cost to the city of any maintenance in there. Any maintenance of that alley would be the responsibility of the property owner because they now own it. If the city vacated the street in front of your house, then what you're calling that lawn strip, as well as, you know, halfway into the middle of the street, would be yours to then do whatever you want with. The city would have no obligation in that circumstance to maintain any of that. So once we vacate, we give up all of our rights to that piece of property.
Okay.
Thank you.
So my only other thing is, Ms. Monson, do you have anything that you wanted to add to or respond to any of the comments that were made?
So, Mr. Brown, you mentioned you thought this was just about safety. If you look at the application, you'll see that there's other items in there. And currently, there's a parking garage that pulls out into the alleyway behind Wing Seminar at 5th and Lincoln. I don't know if you've looked at the site plan. What we want to be able to do is continue developing that particular building. And to do that with handicap accessibility into the building, we want to be able to develop the back end of it and continue to provide more businesses to come down to the Whitaker neighborhood and have that space. So it's about developing what's there as well. That's not the only reason. I mean, it's a $5,000 application fee, and it's more than just that. And it's a $36,000 alley. Hipsters Gymnastics, CB put that in there with the chagrin of the whole Occupy Eugene being right across the street. He almost didn't do that. He's done an amazing job down there. That building looks great. He hasn't taken away from the Whitaker neighborhood. He hasn't taken away from the residents. And he's done everything he can for the safety. We have lockable, programmable doors. We have video cameras that's on surveillance in my office. He does everything he can for the safety of those people down there. And this is just another way of providing safety.
I see.
Thank you for that. All right, at this point, we normally close the public hearing and the public record. So unless I hear otherwise, I'm going to say the record hearing and the record are closed. Okay. All right, with that, we're done with this one. And we will move on to public hearing number 4. An ordinance providing for withdrawal of annexed properties from the River Road Park and Recreation District. City Manager.
The purpose of the public hearing on this item is to hear all public comments on the proposed withdrawal of annexed properties from special service districts. These withdrawals come before the Council on an annual basis. This year, the batch contains the 3 annexations approved by the City in 2012 for a total of 5 tax lots, all of which were initiated by the property owners. Timing for adoption of the ordinance is critical. State statutes provide that any properties to be withdrawn must be withdrawn by March 31st, 2013. Otherwise, those properties will remain on the tax rolls of special service districts until July 2013. Council action is scheduled for January 28th.
Okay. I'm going to open the public hearing. There's no one has signed up. I'm going to close the public hearing and ask council if there's any questions or comments. Okay, we're going to move on now to public hearing number 5, an ordinance concerning urban animal keeping standards. Manager.
This public hearing is on a package of code amendments to increase the number of farm animals allowed within the city limits. The goal of these amendments is to allow for increased opportunities for residential urban farming while addressing compatibility within the urban environment. These are the culmination of City Council direction over the past several years to facilitate urban agriculture and support locally produced food for greater sustainability and livability.
Thank you, City Manager. I'm going to open the public hearing. We have 8 people signed up, and I want to thank you for waiting this long to be heard. I appreciate that. Bill Bezek is first, and Denise Swanson is second. I mispronounced your name. I'm sorry. Yep.
Mayor Piercy, members of the council, my name is Bill Bazook, and I'm the owner of the Eugene Backyard Farmer. My business is located at the corner of 5th and Washington. I happily live in Ward 2, and I'm proud to do business in Ward 7. There is no doubt in my mind the city of Eugene has its heart in the right place. Indeed, as it was mentioned, the proposed statement of increasing urban livestock is to allow for more opportunities for residential animal keeping as well as farming within city limits. Regretfully, these proposed regulations contain a number of flaws that in many cases will make urban farming more restrictive. My concerns are numerous and will exceed my timeline, so I'll also ask for you to accept some written testimony that I will provide shortly. As the owner of the area's premier urban farming supply store, I have a unique perspective in terms of seeing what really is happening in people's backyards all around town. Indeed, I was identified as a stakeholder. I was involved throughout the entire process with the Planning Commission to date. The first several drafts were reasonable and did a very good job of balancing the rights of urban farmers with the rights of non-urban farmers. I get it. There's always going to be a numbers game. There are always going to be people who feel left out, and you cannot please everyone. However, the most recent proposals included both language and numbers that seemed to come, quite frankly, from out of nowhere, and the effect on urban farming I found to be rather shocking. The definition of urban farming is to take an urban space like a backyard and layer in various aspects of micro farming. This includes gardening, chickens, ducks, fruit trees, nut trees, perhaps bees, perhaps turkeys, perhaps rabbits, and perhaps other urban micro livestock. The proposed limits on the types and amounts of animals that can be allowed is bad for both food security as well as bad for business. So I do ask for you to consider my written testimony, specifically how it relates to section 9.5250-4 before any decisions are made. Thank you for your time, and who can I provide a written comment to?
Denise Swanson is next, followed by Jeannie Harden.
Hi, my name is Denise Swanson, and I live in the urban growth boundary east of Springfield. It would give me great pleasure to say I'm a resident of Eugene. However, because I have two goats I would love to have in the city, currently I can't live in Eugene. And so I'm here to ask you to allow goats in the city, and therefore I'd be glad to move and be a resident here. I want to support the ordinances you've actually outlined. I think they're really well thought out and good. And with that, you already have noising and fencing regulations in place for Eugene. And while I have two goats, and they're fixed males, I've had them for 12 years. I've raised them since they were 2.5 weeks old. They don't know that they're goats, and I would hate to break their hearts to tell them otherwise. But I would say perhaps I'm happy with two, but you might want to consider maybe a limit of even up to four. So for say if you had two female goats and they happen to have babies, like two babies, it would at least allow for an option of that to occur. They definitely need shelter. I'm glad that you mentioned that. I just take that for granted that they would have to have it, but I'm glad you put that in there. With the limitation on fences, as small as they are, this isn't a representation of how tall he actually is. The head's a little distorted, but that's the actual height of them. They can't scale a 6-foot fence. I would have to leave a gate unlocked for them to think about getting out to do that. You definitely want the males fixed, because I know that female goats find it very enticing, the smell of a male goat. I don't happen to find that very, very nice. So for your neighbors, you would want to have that. Definitely keep the food in the pest containers, pest-proof containers, you talked about that, and having a closed compost bin. I find that all very good, and what we run and use in our property that we have. Just an aside for the goats, they're wonderful little composters, and I brought this because I work for the University of Oregon, and my coworkers fill two of these every Monday. I have at least one a day that I take home that wouldn't otherwise be put in the landfills.
rely on having daily. When it comes to the fall and you have the windfall apples, the 5-gallon buckets come home to me regularly. If you have a discarded Christmas tree, goats would eat that if it wasn't covered with flocking material. So they're great little composters, and I have many of the coworkers have the manure that they produce, which is basically the size of plump little raisins. That's what it consists of. So I just find that the personality and the guidelines you should put in here would be very compatible with being neighborhood. We've been successful with that. I don't have anything eating my goats, so keeping them in a contained environment with the fencing has been very good for them. I want them in there to protect them, and I want them not to be in anybody else's yard as well. The biggest predator I've ever had to worry about, cougar in the area included, neighborhood dogs running around. So my benefit to have them penned up, and they appreciate that. Thanks for hearing me.
Jeannie Harden is next, followed by Judy Scher.
Good evening, Council. I live just outside of the city of Eugene, and I keep Nigerian dwarf goats. We've got a herd of 9 goats, and I've had a wonderful dairy year. I cannot tell you what it's like to have pounds and pounds of cheddar put up in the garage. It is beautiful, not to mention the chef and the feta and everything. The goats, when they're born, are 1 pound, and they're so small that I have to keep my cats away from them because I don't trust my cats. They're really tiny. And when they grow up, I did see that silhouette. The head of my biggest goat comes this high. I would wonder why, how many dogs are people allowed to keep in Eugene?
Three?
Yeah, I can't imagine why we would want fewer goats than dogs, because they have much less impact. They're not as noisy. They're not as stinky. They're not dangerous. They really love a crowd. They get noisier if there's one. I would really strongly recommend, instead of up to 2, saying from 2 to 4. 1, I've heard people say, ought to be illegal. I've heard of people who said that 1 goat would languish and be miserable and probably, not be... Not be good for the neighborhood. Maybe it would be a noisy goat. Maybe it would just be languishing. But when you see a small crowd, wow, I think that people will be celebrating everywhere. 2 to 4 would be a much better number for these little guys. And really, they're 1 pound when they're born. They're got to be there. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Judy Scher is next, followed by Katja Kohler Gauss, it looks like.
Good evening. My name is Judy Scher.
Would you mind moving closer to the microphone, please?
Okay. My name is Judy Scher. I'm an urban beekeeper in Ward 1, and my neighbors love my bees. I am past president of Lane County Beekeepers Association. I'm a journeyman beekeeper working on a master level with Washington State, and I'm helping to develop the Oregon State Master Beekeepers Program up at OSU. I believe if there must be a limit on the number of hives, a good beekeeper should be able to keep a maximum of 4 hives on any size lot. It's reasonable to have 2 strong hives plus 1 or 2 nucleus hives, and that's because beekeepers juggle, and a nucleus hive is a very small half-size box for bees. In the spring, the beekeeper can combine a nuke with a weak hive or replace a lost hive from the winter with a nuke and start over again. Conversely, bees can be taken out of a strong hive and combined with a nuke, and this relieves the strong hive of congestion, thereby greatly reducing the swarm impulse. During the year, a practical beekeeper also uses nukes just in case a strong hive loses a queen. So what we're doing is that we don't have a set number of hives. We're juggling all the time. And of course, that means we get extra small hives, and what we do with anything, most beekeepers can sell them or relocate them to the country. I also advocate that beekeepers provide multiple sources of water on their property so the bees don't go into other people's swimming pools. And beekeepers should be encouraged to become educated about proper year-round maintenance of their hives to promote good hive health, disease control, and swarm control. Beekeepers should use the local resources such as Lane County Beekeepers Association and or enroll in Oregon Master Beekeepers Program. Now about swarms, there is a list on the Lane County Beekeeper website, and people with swarms are welcome to go there because beekeepers love to collect them. And I think this is an asset, the more beekeepers in town, then you have this asset of a swarm collection. So, that's it.
Thank you. Perfect. Gotcha, Kohler Koss. Gotcha.
Right there.
Oh, there she is. Okay, followed by Catherine Hunt.
Good evening. My name is Katya. I live in Cottage Grove, and I want to first thank everyone that's been involved in working on the urban farm ordinance. Although it's been a while since I've read it, I thought it looked good when I first read it, the first drafts of it, so I'm curious about what you were talking about, but I think
good.
It's...
That's good.
Okay. I think it's invaluable to encourage more local food grown in our cities. We really need to work towards this to be more sustainable and healthy. 2 years ago, we lived in Eugene. We gardened and raised chickens for meat and eggs. Our sons, now 13, wanted to also raise companion pets. We really wanted to have furry, lovable pets that wouldn't be dangerous to others, that wouldn't bark, that would go on walks with us easily, that didn't have smelly poops, and maybe our pets could even give us back nutritious food and manure for the garden. So we decided on goats. We met other goat owners in Seattle, San Francisco, and Portland. They not only have them as pets, but they milk their goats too. Unfortunately, they weren't legal here, so we decided to meet with our council person, George Brown, and organized a group of folks that came here to speak with you about this issue. And now I'm really glad, we're really glad that it's gotten to this point now. Thank you. We got impatient, though, and moved to Cottage Grove where we would where we could afford to live on 7 acres. Now we have chickens, a rooster, ducks, rabbits, goats, and even a cow. And let me tell you, they are healthy and happy and currently live in a paddock the size of our city lot where we used to live in Eugene. The goats and cow, mainly, the ducks and the chickens also roam through there. But we do take the goats on walks for browsing, and we bring the cows a lot of greens and hay. When it's not raining, we move her with electric fencing on the grass, but because we haven't been able to afford a perimeter fence around all the property, we mostly keep them in a paddock and bring them good food, haylage and blackberry leaves, and clean out the barn regularly and compost the manure. In the summer, they also love the dandelions, comfrey, and blackberry leaves. My kids visit with the animals often. They brush them and bring them treats and help milk the cow. It's very doable to raise animals like goats and cows in smaller spaces. They just need more care like a dog and cat does. Dogs and cats aren't always hunting for the food. It's a responsibility, but it sure pays back with yummy and healthy food. I'm not advocating for cows in the city, but I just wanted to point out that our two goats do fine in the paddock the size of our old city lot, about 5,000 square feet. So maybe the extra two goats could replace the space of the cow, too. Harvesting blackberries.
Thank you.
Wow, that's nuts. Thank you.
Thank you. Catherine Hunt is next, followed by Barbara Elliott.
My name is Catherine Hunt. I live at 130 Hansel
Lane. Right up close to the mic.
Even closer?
Yeah, that's
good. Better?
Okay.
Tonight I'm directing my comments on the section dealing with honeybees. My husband and I are beekeepers. Currently, I'm also the president of the Lane County Beekeepers Association. I would recommend that beekeepers be allowed to keep at least 4 hives on residential property under 20,000 square feet, and thus more than 4 on above 20,000 square feet, for the following reasons. Honeybees help to pollinate our gardens, our food, and our fruit trees. We need more hives to be able to do swarm control by splitting strong hives. If we are only allowed 2 hives and they're both strong, then we won't be able to split. Also, we need more hives so we can collect swarms and keep honeybees from making their homes in other structures. Bees fly 3 miles to collect pollen and nectar, so the size of the yard to the number of hives does not make sense, as bees don't necessarily stick close by but go where the nectar source is located. The Lane County Beekeepers Association keeps a swarm list, as we are contacted by both individuals and the city. Members of the club are happy to collect swarms, but if they can't keep at least 4 hives, they won't be able to do this service. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak.
Barbara Elliott is next, followed by Keegan Coughlin.
I'm Barbara Elliott, and I currently live
Get close to the mic.
I live in Santa Clara, and I am a beekeeper. And I am in agreement with my cohorts over here that we need to have at least 4 hives per 20,000 square foot. We have 1 hive that we ordered, then my son captured 2 swarms. So if you were by your rules of only 2 hives in the yard, then we would be illegal. Those 2 swarms were caught in my backyard. If we weren't able to have 4 hives, then we would have a problem. All bees need to have a home, and in order to do that, we have to have the hives. And in to prevent the swarms, we have to be able to split those hives. So if we split them, then we have more than 2 hives. And if you have 2 hives and you have to split, then you have 4 hives. And even at that, they may still swarm. So in order to keep this under control and still be able to have pollination for our gardens and our fruit trees, we need at least 4 hives per 20,000 square foot. Thank you.
Thank you. Keegan Coughlin is the last one up.
Hello, council members, mayor. My name is Keegan Coughlin, and I'm an avid urban farmer. I've lived in Eugene for 6 years now and am extremely ecstatic about it. And ever since I moved here, I was blown away by the innovation and creativity that people do in their backyards. With that said, I believe that this proposal is too strict and based off of arbitrary numbers that don't necessarily pan out in actual applications. I think that if we left it up to the people that are really experimenting with this stuff and doing it in a proper sanitary way, I think that would be a much better approach than trying to put on a measure that is much too top down. I think that the real innovations that you've seen in the city in agriculture have come, in urban agriculture in particular, have come from a bottom-up approach with people doing things. One example that I just wanted to mention to kind of show, to demonstrate what I'm talking about. I raised rabbits in the city, among other things, and I recently read the measure and was kind of appalled at the fact that you can only have 6 rabbits that are under the age of 6 months. My rabbits, I'm pleased to say, often have litters of 9 or more, which is generally something that you want to encourage if you're raising rabbits for meat. With that said, I don't think I think that the proposal needs to be looked at much more, and it also I guess I'm just here to speak on behalf of my other youth, my other younger peers and cohorts that weren't here today, but to tell you that people my age are experimenting with this stuff, and it would be extremely discouraging to them to apply restrictive measures that that don't actually pan out in reality. I think Bill Bezuk has compiled a very accurate list of things to look at, and I would really. But I appreciate everything that you guys have done, and I really appreciate the fact that you're looking at urban agriculture as something that is going to be here to stay, and something that's going to improve our community for the long run. So thank you.
I'm going to close the hearing, and I'm going to ask council if there's any questions or comments anybody has. I will start with Councillor Evans.
Thank you, Mayor. I have a question for staff on the two goat limitation, and as I look at the Planning Commission recommendation that that anything over two goats, that there's a 5,000 square foot requirement for you to have those additional goats, and I heard the testimony for 2 to 4 goats and the reasons behind that in terms of forming kind of this I guess community or goat family, if you will, that promotes the health of the goats and that kind of thing. What would be besides the limitations, why are the limitations there in terms of the, you know, the additional goats? So if we went to say 2 to 4 goats, would that, you know, what kinds of things are driving that kind of policy?
My name's Christy Brown.
Talk right into the mic.
My name's Christy Brown, and I'm with Building Permit Services. And the proposal originally was for two tiers. One is 20,000 square foot lots and less, or 20,000 square foot or greater. So first, to answer your question, the number for the two goats was assuming any lot size under 20,000 square feet. So you obviously have a huge range in that. I think that's what you've heard tonight, is people wanting that smaller lot allowance to be increased. On the larger lots, 20,000 square feet or greater, it was viewed, and that was an addition by the Planning Commission on the area requirement for additional miniature goats of the 5,000 square feet, and it was viewed, I think, really as still trying to limit the overall number. Goats were not an allowed animal type prior to this proposal, whereas chickens, for an example, rabbits, there was no limit on the number on those lots that were over 20,000 square feet. So those are some of the changes, and looking at making those restricted also made them look at the goat restriction as well. So it's more relative to the size of the lot. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, kind of, sort of.
It was a process.
I understand the process, yeah. But, you know, it kind of strikes me as a little bit arbitrary with regard to the number. I'm just trying to, I'll go back through the documents and kind of review that again, but I may have some more questions later.
We'll also provide you a follow-up memo with a little bit more information on that.
Yeah, that helped me clarify that for me.
Councilor Brown?
Thank you, Mayor. Thanks, everyone, for coming. I think that this ordinance is, I think staff did a very good job. This ordinance is a big improvement over what went before, but it has a ways to go, I believe, after, and I'm even more confirmed in that after listening to the testimony tonight. I'm somewhat familiar with some of the things you guys were talking about, so I will probably be asking counselors to approve some amendments to this, fairly minor amendments. The reason that people want to have three or four goats is because goats are very social animals, and they really do best when they're with other goats. And one will languish, and two is better. Three is really ideal, and four is a good amount. And, you know, comparing it with, I don't have them with me, but we got copies of ordinances from other cities in Washington and, like Seattle and San Francisco and Austin, Texas, and all kinds of things. And this is not as good as it could be. It doesn't match. Some of those other ones, I think, were better. No reported problems from any cities of things being out of hand with three or four goats. So I'm going to make some kind of a motion to amend that section. And Mr. Bazook, you had said that you had seen earlier drafts of this amendment, and then that it changed in a way that you didn't like. If you could give me copies of how it started out, and I can compare it with how it ended up, and we can see if we can't make some. Yes,
it's actually attachment C as part of your AIS packet, which was
the initial. Mm-hmm. Okay, I missed that. I'm sorry. No. Good. All right, never mind. I'll look it up. The beekeeper's proposals make total sense to me. I have a friend of mine who's a beekeeper out in the county. He's got four hives. He explained it to me. I think it's really the way to go. You have two strong hives, and you have two nuclear hives. And they don't take up a lot of space. They don't hang around in the neighborhood. They get up in the morning and they go to work, and they go long distances, and they pollinate all kinds of fruit trees. And without them, we probably wouldn't be here. They're very important. And my friend also makes honey that he sells to stores, including ours. And so he helps the family income, and it's great honey. So I'm going to be asked, I will probably ask for an amendment to that one too, and increase it to four hives. And I think that's all. Thank you.
Do you have anything?
No.
Okay, over here.
I just had a process question.
Yes.
If Councilor Brown in this instance makes proposed changes to the ordinance, do we reschedule a hearing on it, or are we able to move forward on the ordinance from there?
You can move forward on it. What we would suggest is for any councilor that has a proposed amendment that you let us know ahead of time, so our attorneys can work with whoever the councilor is to make sure it reads how you want it to read, and then that would be presented to the council for your consideration as well.
Thanks.
Councilor Taylor.
I'm concerned about neighbors of these urban farmers and how they may feel about it. Is there some kind of way that people can complain if the odor is too much, or if it's attracting too many flies and that sort of thing?
Absolutely. Part of this package actually is amendment to Chapter 4 that gives our land use code enforcers the authority to enforce these sections, mostly relating to noise, which already exists but usually is enforced by EPD. So that is a change as part of this associated with those farm animals. The sanitation piece, fencing, enclosures, those things we're trying, and setbacks would all be enforced by the code enforcement staff.
And how will you know if people have male, is it only male goats that smell, is that true?
Yeah. Yeah, and every jurisdiction
I've lived in a neighborhood where there were goats, and they did smell.
Right. So that's why the neutering requirement that you see in there.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, anybody else? All right, that ends our business of the day. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
See you at noon tomorrow.